Yes, I could take over the show.
So maybe he's really kind looking, maybe he's not kind.
I mean, it's our show. So anyway, we're here today.
Yeah.
And the past couple weeks we started with trailer trash,
right.
But we thought that was a little abrupt. So we're going to do something a little different today. And so we decided we're going to do a new segment called How You Doing? And I'm going to ask Mitch, how are you doing?
The world's been pretty static for the most part for me, like on the entertainment front, work front, and things like that. Although some recent voiceover work has come into my lap, which has been fun and interesting.
How do you get voiceover work? Do people reach out to you? Do you audition for that? How does that work?
Yeah, it can come in many different areas where you can audition for it. There are places that you can actually become a member of, and they will provide opportunities to audition. Things like Voices123 or Voices.com, Voice123, and they'll put up auditions, you audition, and if they like you, then they give you the job. Some jobs actually pay you to audition, like if you really don't.
Nice.
So very limited select people that say, hey, I need you to audition, I'll pay you $50 to do this, and then if you get the job, then, you get whatever. Probably, I don't know how it works, but I haven't started actually tapping into that yet. The first one that I got was based off a relationship that I made through the Bug Phone.
Okay, which is now on Amazon.com, so if you haven't seen it, and you have Amazon Prime, definitely check it out. It has Pierre Rumpf,
yep.
Who's a good friend of ours, and we had the Garcia brothers on, I think, last year.
Cool, dude.
So definitely check out Blood Throne on Amazon.com.
Which is kind of just ended up poor. Well, I don't tell you what's
the story,
but so now I've got a renewed focus on that side of things. So I need to get a demo done, and so I've got some scripts that I've picked out. I'm gonna rehearse those a little bit, and then I find a recording artist to go to a studio, have them record it, put some music to it, and actually sound like a real commercial because these are mostly real scripts. And put myself out there. So
that's cool.
Yeah, so that'll be kind of fun.
And I heard you have like a really early morning pickup tomorrow.
I do, yeah. I'm going to be up at 3:30 in the morning, so I'll be up at 2:30 to get to Nashville for whatever. And then,
fun.
Yeah, but that's what you do freelancing. You find the work, you do what you can, and make the money until the cool stuff comes in.
Well, hopefully, you get some good stories out of it. You know, whenever something happens, I tell people, well, that will look great in your autobiography. And they're like, that doesn't happen.
Yeah. Yeah. I've got some great Uber stories, let me tell you. There's a good friend of mine, somebody I've done some theater work, a couple of shows with, and I wanted to send her a blanket to watch the show. But anyways.
But she should watch the show.
She should watch the show, anyways. And so maybe I'll force her to watch it on the way to the bus. So then again, so.
Now, do you have your own website? Because I don't think we've ever plugged it on the show.
Yeah.
Why don't you plug it now?
That's MitchFortierOnline.com.
MitchFortierOnline.com.
Correct. www.MitchFortierOnline.com. And it's got my demo reel. It's got a little bit about me, a bunch of pictures and things, and my resume and all that good stuff. So it's pretty basic, but I did it myself. And so what's up with you?
Oh, so what's up with me was I have a website too. It's www.KillarneyTraynor.com. And I just redid it, so it's got this whole fresh new look on it, which I really like. It's got kind of a Nancy Drew feel to it.
Nice.
Which I really like. Because I grew up reading Nancy Drews, and I feel like my whole life I've been trying to be Nancy Drew. You know, limited success.
I know a little about Nancy Drew. I know the name, so if you describe her in a sentence or two, what would
she's
it be?
She's a well-dressed detective who drives in a light blue convertible and just has awesome adventures solving mysteries. Half the time, like, in a haunted house or on, like, a ranch or some far-off place.
Okay.
When I was a kid, they had a crossover series with her in the Hardy Boys. And they would always be, like, in some exotic location, like, you know, an archaeologist. Thank you.
Archaeological.
Thank you. Or, like, this train through Europe, and they, you know, there was always bad guys that they were fighting and stuff like that. And, again, I wanted to be her. So I have a new website, and I actually blog on there. I've been doing it really regularly lately. So I do book reviews and just stuff like that. So if anyone wants to check it out, let me know what you think. If you think I'm wrong about my book reviews, definitely leave a comment because I want to start some arguments. Who knows, but we can argue. So that's what I've got. And you know the dinner party.
I do.
Yeah, so we worked on that. We've been talking about it for 2 years straight. People are like, is it ever going to come out?
Right.
It actually is.
But I've seen a cut of it, though.
Yeah, you have. Yeah. I saw the rough cut. You're really kind about it. I appreciate that. So we're almost done getting back all the feedback from the festivals and stuff like that. And it looks like we're going to have a release either at the end of April or the beginning of May. So everyone stay tuned for that because it's going to be a lot of fun.
Very cool.
It's going to be a lot of fun.
Yeah,
so, yeah, I know. It's like, it's been a long journey. We learned a lot. And, so it should be good.
Nice.
Yeah.
So, Terry, what's going on? Oh, never mind.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, just,
he's not here.
Yeah.
I don't know what he's been up to.
Yeah.
No.
Probably not good if I am going to Terry.
He had a lot of opinions, I know, about some of the news topics that you're going to be talking about, like writer's strike and stuff like that. And I know he had a very strong opinion about the Spencer trailer that we're going to be talking about.
So did some other people on our Facebook page.
Oh, good.
There's a really good comment that I read, and I was like, wow, okay, all right. So that was a really big point. Honestly, it was kind of weird, but nonetheless, he just, somebody had remembered it, and I didn't realize until I read it that this is like, it's sort of Spencer genre story.
I think it was a TV show, yeah.
Right.
I know my mom had a massive crush on the guy who played him. I think it was Robert Ulrich that played the original Spencer.
Yeah, might be nice of him.
My brother Spencer's not named after him. He was named after somebody else. But it was unusual at the time, I think, because it was actually filmed in Boston, and the actor moved his family out here. At least that's the story I was told. And he died rather young, very tragically. But
I'm guessing that this was filmed in Boston, too.
Yes, well, it has Mark Wahlberg in it, so it's like, so Boston.
Yeah.
So Boston. But I feel like we're doing Trailer Trash before we... We're supposed to be doing Trailer Trash.
That's right. Yeah.
I'm just getting excited. Yeah.
Kelly's
not here.
Patrick's going to go for the film, so we're looking forward to seeing what he...
And Patrick's going to be...
It's about the trailers in general.
I know. And he's going to be on the couch in a few minutes talking about what it's like to be on the other side of film festival. So he's a filmmaker who has his own film festival, and he's part of the process of deciding, of selecting which film's going to this film festival, which...
Which is going to be daunting.
I can't imagine how hard that is.
I'm watching all of that footage.
Yeah. I reviewed books for an indie magazine. So I read three to five indie books a month for a year and a half. And I write books and I'm independently published. So it's really hard to write reviews for your peers because you know what the struggle is, you know?
Okay.
So it'll be really hard because sometimes someone would write a great book or they have a great idea that was badly done. And so you're looking at this going like, oh, you should have edited this or you should have had your friends read this. You shouldn't have put this out yet. And I can only imagine that it's that but worse.
Well, that's kind of what I was saying too. It's some stuff, I mean, you can never imagine you're watching and you're just like, this is unwatchable.
Yeah.
And that would be the hard part, but to give it its due credit and actually watch it and finish it, so I'm curious to see how he kind of gets through that part of things, too. Okay. Speaking of watching stuff, I saw 1917 this weekend.
What'd you think?
And it was very engaging. It was the kind of film that you go to watch, when I go to see a film, I want to lose everything about life and
kind
of get sucked in and when this film did that from the get-go. And part of it was due to the fact that it was a one-shot style. Now, it turns out it wasn't actually one shot. It was actually just really cleverly edited. And
yeah, I heard there's actually 43 different shots that they use, and then that's what I read.
Okay.
So, and I haven't seen it yet, but they said they kind of disguise them with, like, fog or something.
Gotcha. Yeah, so there were a couple of moments where I'm like, okay, that would have been a cut, probably, and things like that. But I didn't really know until after the fact that it really truly was done in pieces. And then put and spliced together.
So let me ask you, because I heard mixed reviews about it, about the style especially.
Yeah.
Did the style detract from the story, do you think?
Not at all. I feel like they went into this thing. I saw the video afterwards, and I could tell. And then they confirmed it. And I'm like, they went into this thing. They were designed, they built the script around this idea.
Okay.
This is the idea. This is how we're going to do it. Now we need to make the story engaging and appropriate and work into this kind of technique or style, and it worked beautifully. It was some surprises around a couple of corners, things that I didn't expect, things that I wished had happened, There's little nitpicky things that I could have picked out in terms of just the overall set design in some cases, but overall it was really impressive.
You got sucked in. So.
I totally did. Yeah, I got lost in the story. I caught up with the characters. I wanted these people to succeed. I wanted to see them get to where they were going, and I could feel the things that they were going through, and been just like the disgust or the fear or the love or whatever the emotion was that they were trying to portray, and it was just amazing to see and how knowing. Like, I don't know how they did some of this stuff. Like, some of it was drone shots, or some of it was, handheld on Ronins or whatever, gimbals.
I saw guys running with cameras in the back, behind-the-scenes shots.
Okay.
Which we've done a few times.
Okay, yeah.
I saw that in this case that they were kind of attached to, like, a thing.
Sure.
So, like, yep. Wires.
They call them goosenecks, and they're hanging off of the thing.
Oh, that's a good idea. I could have used that. Few times I screwed up.
When the camera weighs 20 pounds, on to a couple of hours, those.
Yeah,
I've done
that a few times. When we were shooting Chance, I was camera woman for a lot of it, and I had to do the big John Wayne shot. And let's just say it was a learning curve because I had to walk backwards over pebbles. And I probably could have used the wire thing because, when I was looking at the footage later, I was like, ooh, I hope they can fix that. And he did. Terry did.
That's cool. Yeah, so there's some pretty impressive equipment out there for these kinds of things. And the cinematographer that did this film, I think it was Roger Deakin, I think is his name, talks a little bit about how he wanted to create film. He wanted to do it on film, like on celluloid. But that was going to be virtually impossible based on the kinds of environments that they were walking through, the weight of it and the lack of the ability to balance it out and how it changes as the film rolls over and things to the other reels. So digital technology made this film possible for all intents and purposes, which is cool to see.
That's cool.
So, 1917, I would totally go check it out if you get an opportunity and see it in the theaters. It was worth it.
Yeah. Oh, that's awesome.
And then hopefully you won't have Frozen sitting in the theater next to you over some of the quiet seats that make it a little hard and makes you have a moment.
What was I watching? We were watching Little Women, and I think 1917 was next to us because it was like a very quiet moment in the movie. You could just hear the boom, boom, boom in the theater next to us.
My friend Abby. Hopefully, she's watching with her friend Casey.
Oh yes,
meant to see what she thought about it as well.
So Bob is here. Hi, Bob. How are you? Bob says it's very distorted sound. Hopefully, they're fixing it back there. Bob also says you saw Knives Out last night, which I've not seen, but I heard that they're making a sequel to, which is pretty cool. But actually, we have to wrap this up because it's 7:14, and we're going to have our guest Dr. Jerome come on. So everyone wants to stay tuned for that. What are you doing?
My eyes are bad. I'm trying to reach. Oh, man. It got softer.
They're still talking about the sound. Yeah. I can't do anything about the sound. I just keep talking until they tell me that it's fixed.
Okay. Well, but we're just going to talk. And sorry about the whole gurgle.
We are sorry. Hopefully they're fixing that. But we're going to be right back. I think they're going to roll something, hopefully.
Roll some stuff.
Maybe.
Yep, about that time, I'm gonna go close the door and stand guard. We don't want a repeat of yesterday, right?
Okay.
I know you wanna silence me. That's bulletproof glass, but you can't touch me.
Get out of here! Get out!
Let's find this thug today.
The police are calling my place early in the morning to request your presence.
Lamont? Ty? Where are you?
Go back home.
Down! Get down!
Oh my God!
We are opening an investigation.
May I ask which officers you're investigating?
All your undercover officers, sir.
Everything we have, all the records indicate that he's the killer, and all you have to do is identify him in court in the near future.
Just get me to the courthouse, that's your job, isn't it?
The trigger man behind the glass is out there. He's everywhere, and he's watching, and he's listening. When he comes for me, where you gonna be?
And welcome back to the Early Late Night Live Show. We are joined by our guest, Executive Director of Boston International Film Festival, Patrick Jerome. In case you're wondering why I'm so somber and serious, it's because the guy out back said we used up all our laughter and joy in the first segment and that we couldn't use anymore. So I'm like, all right, well, I got you, man. Anyways.
Mitch always takes direction.
Yeah, I do. I like to take direction. I don't think I can take direction well. So, a quick question. Was that Arisa in the actress Arisa? What's that?
Arisa Page.
Arisa Page, yes, thank you. So she's a fantastic individual.
Yeah, in Assassin Behind the Glass. Great actress. I mean, it was a wonderful experience, but I would like to talk more about the Boston International Film Festival.
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah. So the executive director of the Boston International Film Festival, and because you started the thing, right? And
yes, that was a long time ago. I was 2002. We were young and naive, and we didn't know what we were getting into. And it becomes what it is. And through the years, oh my goodness. I mean, when you look at the number of movies that we had to screen and preview and go on, it goes on and on and on. I mean, let's say over 25,000, 30,000 films.
Over the life,
of the festival.
So, and you've been a part of watching all of those? Is that
at the beginning, yes.
Yeah.
Okay. I kind of play a different role, with final, selection stage.
Okay.
But it is a great, process. It's like a school, really, for everything you have to go through to really, see what the movies are all about, where they come from, who make them, and there's a number of things that are just incredible.
I've sat in a couple of forums where they had festival runners coming up, people who work and build their own festivals. It was down in Massachusetts during the Sci-Fi Film Festival, and they talked about how they procure films and things like that, and how the business of it and the ideas that they bring into trying to create a film festival, what it is they're trying to do, and it sounded like an exceptional learning process. And what is it that you feel that you've learned the most about in terms of your involvement in creating this festival?
I don't know. I think being a witness of, the technology, development and improvement, from year to year, it's just amazing. It's a mind-blowing experience for me. Still, because when we just started the festival, we had more movies submitted on VHS tape than DVDs.
That's right.
Okay?
Yeah.
It takes some years to switch to DVDs.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Okay? Yeah. And then from DVDs, and then you started seeing everybody want to submit their film on Blu-rays, as Blu-ray become available.
Sure.
Then you have mini DVD tapes. And then you have MOV. And then now we are at a point
where thumb drives and streaming.
Yes. Now every movie come online with the link for you to watch it. It's just like, it's amazing to see, to witness, the progression of technology and how artistically filmmakers, adjust to it and use it, as time goes by. That's a big learning experience. And even when we started to do the festival in terms of exhibitions, where we used to play digibeta tapes, three-quarter tapes, and then it go to mini DV, and then when you go to theaters, it was used to have 35 millimeter films, and then now you have DCP all over,
Yeah, it's pretty wild.
So, being in that position to witness, what's happening artistically in the film industry. Not only that, with the equipment that people use at the time to film a movie, and now it's completely different. I mean, it's easier now and better quality now. But one thing that is amazing, it's like the quality of a movie remains the same. Like the screenwriters still have the power. The concept of the movie is what makes the movie what it is, you know. And you can't buy that anywhere. It doesn't matter how much money you have for your equipment, for your budget and stuff.
Sure.
But the ideas, that bring a story together, that's the most powerful thing that will remain, I guess, forever.
So tell me about what year did you start this? It was in the early 90s probably, right?
No, 2002.
2002, and you're still getting VHSs back then?
Yeah, no kidding.
Oh,
let me just interrupt you for a second. Pierre Rump says, hi, Patrick. So.
Yes. How you doing, man?
When you started the film festival, what was the idea behind it, or just in general, what was your motivation for doing it? And then how do you stay motivated now, and what do you want people to know about the festival that might help them understand why they should submit?
Or why they shouldn't submit.
Actually, on my first feature film in the U.S., Deportation, I made it in 2000. And after we make the film, it ended up being selected in a bunch of film festivals across the United States. That's what introduced me really to the film festival, you know, world.
Right.
So, you know, I went, you know, we had presentation here in Boston. I mean, in Boston, we are in New Hampshire.
Yeah.
Yeah, right. So, and then, you know, we had the world premiere in New York, and then we went to Las Vegas, Los Angeles, all across the United States, and then... So that's kind of opened my eyes, really, with all the experience that I was having with film festivals, you know, playing my own film. We shot on Super 16mm, and it was like, you know, a very hard and difficult time, you know, to make a movie, and we put all our efforts in it.
Right.
And then after this movie, we managed to raise $500,000 to make my next film, A Haul at Me. And then after we make the film... And then we had a big budget. We had people coming from Hollywood, from New York, and we shut down at the Cape. And then after that, we were like, what are we going to do? You know, how are we going to present it here in Boston? Oh, my God, I keep saying here in Boston.
That's fine.
We're talking about Boston's kind of ours.
Yes,
so.
yes, it's kind of ours. But anyway, we said, how are we going to present it? So that's how we came with the idea, and I met with the team that we were working with at the time. And I said, you know what, I've seen so many international film festivals as I travel across the country, but I don't see one in Boston. So why don't we, try to do, you know, a film festival? So we were looking for a name for the film festival, like, you know, the Moonlight Film Festival, the Sunshine Film Festival. And then all of a sudden, I had a TV show called International Rhythms on Channel 26, you know. In Boston, and then we were like, wait a minute, we don't have a Boston International Film Festival. So the first thing we did, we went online and we checked, no, there's no Boston International Film Festival. We were like, wow, what about if we call it Boston International Film Festival? So the next day we called the mayor's office.
Okay.
They sent us to the cultural departments, and then we explained what we want to do. He says, okay, let's set up a meeting. Really? Okay. In 3 weeks, they give us a meeting. We went there. Met with the mayor's staff, we pitched out the idea, and it was a little scary, you know, as, you know, we're pitching the idea, this is what we'd like to do, and blah, 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 and they didn't see anything, and at the end, they were like, wow, what a great idea, let's do it, you know, and then, you know, we work with them, they explain to us how we can do it, you know, legally and formally to do it, you know.
Were there tax credits back then?
Tax credit had always been in existence,
yeah.
But I don't think we had such a high tax, you know, credit. I mean, film production was very low in Boston at that time. So when I film my movie Deportation, you rarely see some Hollywood movies at that time coming to Boston. Like, you know, I'm not even sure if it was 5 movies a year at that time.
Mm.
You know, when you look at the time again, it's totally different. So anyway, so that's how it gets started. So we had a big crew, we had a staff, and we just get so busy, so crazy.
Yep.
We push it, and we get bombarded with submissions. And we had great support from the mayor, Thomas, the late Thomas Menino at that time. It was wonderful to us, you know. They help us, you know, for the big chunk of the festival, the first 10 years. They printed big posters of the Boston International Film Festival and posted around Boston.
Cool.
Wow.
So they printed themselves and then posted themselves and a bunch of support that we had, you know. I mean, it was a great, you know, experience, you know.
Yeah. So what keeps it going now? What's the
Well, the thing that keeps it going, it's because, you know, a lot of us that come together, you know, have something to do in the film industry. So, you know, it's amazing to see how the festival impact people's life in a positive way. It gives people so many opportunities. I remember the first year of the film festival, we had a movie that we played at the festival. It was a launch, a short film, and then it ended up being nominated for an Oscar, you know, in terms of, you know, the short films. And then it kept going on and on and on. We kept getting a lot of attention from movies, from Hollywood, and filmmakers in Hollywood, established filmmakers, you know, stars and so on. So that's kind of, you know, make it what it is today.
Yeah, I've been to a couple of them over the years, and there were people from overseas, the people that travel with their films, which is something that was new to me. I'm like, oh my God, they're spending a lot of money traveling with their films to promote their product. And then, but they are doing it at the Boston International Film Festival. How many countries? I mean, all over the world.
I mean, every year we have at least 32 countries that we played movies from at the festival.
That's so cool.
And then, you know, it's a very interesting process after we select the film, and then we go to a legal process to help people get a visa to come here.
Okay.
So it's a big operation in itself.
Yeah.
You know, that's very, very
You guys
very
have a hand
busy.
In helping people come across overseas to come and
we have to make a visa petition for the filmmaker.
No kidding.
Wow.
Yes.
So I want to ask, so someone makes a film, mm-hmm. and they say, oh, I'm going to submit it to the Boston Film Festival, and they submit it to you.
Boston International.
International Film Festival.
Yes.
What happens after they send you the film? Like, what's the process that it goes through when you guys make that determination?
Well, the way we watch movies, we have a committee of about 35 people that got together every weekends and watch movies. So basically, you know, they would sit around the table, and everybody would have a little flag in front of them, and of course it's like a party. We have food, and we used to have, you know, some little drink. I says, no more. Like people
start to,
I must get some funny commentary. I love this movie.
But anyway, you know, people would sit around and would watch a film, and then, you know, if there are 12 people, you know, around the table, if 6 flags goes down, we keep watching. The 7th flag, we stop the movie and move to the next one.
Oh, okay, so you
so
may not...
So basically, the majority of the people have to see the potential of the film to play it in the festival.
Okay.
So, but anyway, some movies are so good, as soon as you start playing it all the way through the end, nobody put their flags down.
Hmm.
And then the other way around, some movies are so bad, after like 5 minutes, everybody put their
flags down. Yeah, because I've got a lot of stuff that I'm just like, I've been there, yeah. No.
So it is a big challenge, you know.
You must get into arguments, too, I would think.
Of course. We've had heated arguments
about
everything, whether it's politics, whether it's, you know, with, you know, our sexual preference, religious belief.
Mm-hmm.
We have all different kind of shocks because it's, we have movies, like I said, from different part of the world, and people have different understanding about, you know, the world, you know, in terms of, you know, human rights, like women's rights, you know, gay rights, you know, all different kind of, you know, complex, you know, things that we face in society, basically.
So you got how many people are sitting at the table?
It depends. So the number of screening, the members are about 35 people altogether.
Okay.
But sometimes in the table there are 10, sometimes 12, sometimes 14, 15.
Okay.
Yeah, it goes like that.
And how often you find yourself arguing based on the merit or the message of the film as opposed to the quality and or the artistic and or technical aspects of the film? Does that usually, is there a clear line there that sometimes happens, or?
Well, when you watch thousands of film, everything happens.
Yeah.
You have so many different scenes.
Yeah.
You know, it's in our use. You have some movies that, you know, are technically so good, and then but artistically really bad. The acting can be really bad, you know. And then some movies, you know, you wanna like the film. Some local film, we want to like them. We want them to be good to play at the festival. But sometimes they are so bad.
Yeah.
We can't.
Oh yeah. I can imagine.
We can't even try.
So we gotta. You know? The segment goes by really fast as usual. But I want to. So I want to give you a chance to tell us whatever it is that you want about the festival to our viewers, our filmmakers that are out there watching. And why they might want to submit.
Well, I think the festival definitely is to give exposure to filmmakers, to give their name out there. And as we always try to get, you know, people from the Hollywood Reporter, Variety Magazine, actually they just wrote to us, you know, to send their representative, you know, AP, cool. You know, news. And I mean, it goes on and on and on. So the more exposure a filmmaker get, the more review they have about their film because it played at the festival and they get, you know, attention to get, you know, distributors to be interested in them and contact them directly,
sure.
You know. So, I mean, which is amazing. Last year's film festival, there's a number of films that Netflix contacted them directly that was played at the
Boston International
Film Festival. Oh, wow. That's very cool.
And with my movie, Assassin Behind the Glass, I have tons of, you know, email coming in from all different kind of, you know, different areas
That's
in terms
great.
Of distribution. So the exposure is there, the opportunity is there, and we are proud that we are able to give this, you know, opportunity to...
Now, how long is it? 4 days, right?
Well, it used to be 10 days.
Okay.
It used to be 10 days, and then about 4 years ago, we reduced it to 6 days, five, 6 days, where we played in multiple theaters. Mm-hmm. We used to be just at the MC Theater for 10 days. We think when we do it shorter and on weekends and evening, it's easier for people to come out and see the movies. But we have multiple theaters, so we can play, you know, still playing, you know, 100, you know, movies, you know.
Okay, yeah, spreading out on different theaters at the same time,
yeah.
Kind of thing. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's an amazing festival. I really enjoy it every time I go down. It's just really well run. The people are super nice, and we have a good time. So we find you at, is it?
BIfilmFestival.com.
BIfilmFestival.com.
Yeah, people can check our website. So we're focusing on having lots of parties. Like really good parties.
I've been to one of them.
Parties are for the hair.
So that's the changes we want to bring because the way the world is right now, you know, everybody's watching movie at home. So the festival is a social, you know, experience.
Makes sense.
People get to meet people one on one.
Absolutely.
Yep. That's why one of the reasons why I go for sure. So awesome. Well, thank you very much for joining us, man.
Well, you're gonna stick around for Trailer Trash, though,
yeah.
Right?
Of course.
All right. Okay. So yeah.
So we're gonna let you watch a short little video, and then we'll be back and do some Trailer Trash.
No!
Again.
What's going on?
Well, we're trying to film a promo for an early late night live show, but Facebook Live keeps kicking us off.
Technical difficulties. Tell me about it.
Oh, okay. All right, here we go. All right. It's the early late night live... Oh,
what are you trying to say?
Well, you know, that people should watch the show because we have so much fun, talk entertainment news and, mm-hmm. you know, things like that. And, you know, of course, my segment.
Yeah.
I swear, Facebook hates us.
You know, hey, maybe if we do this.
Ooh. Huh.
Whoops. Accidental selfie.
Yeah, okay, look, let me.
I got this.
No, you apparently don't.
No, I
You don't actually know what you're doing.
All right. It's my phone.
Yeah, no, listen, let me do it.
Oh,
let me do
guys.
It. You're acting like such a girl.
Oh my gosh, you
guys.
Help.
What? We're live.
Hey. Join us Wednesday night, 7 p.m., Exeter Channel 98.
And on YouTube, when it works.
Mm-hmm. And we will talk entertainment news and trash some trailers. And then, of course, we've got my segment. So don't miss it. Join us on Wednesday night at 7 p.m.
It'll be fun.
Yeah.
Siblings.
What's going on?
Oh, hey, we're starting a new show.
I'm hosting.
So are we. I even wore my suit.
Yeah, we thought at this point it would be probably a little bit better to aim at a younger audience, so we hired Kate. And them.
Wait, them? Our names are them?
Shut up.
Except we won't talk sports, we're not gonna talk politics, just entertainment.
That's the same as my show.
Or not that original.
Get out.
Stay.
Terry, this is my show.
Want to keep your job?
You're fired.
Oh, what?
I'm here.
Show's canceled.
Damn it.
All right, all set.
Where's Ernie? I told her 9 o'clock.
Oh, she'll be here.
I'm here, guys. I'm here. Oh, you look great.
Thanks.
Arnie?
Yeah.
We're supposed to be filming promos for the early late night live show.
Yeah, I know.
What? Yeah, and didn't you get the text message about the Dress code?
Oh, right, yeah, you said dress appropriately.
And?
Well, I thought you said that on this show, you represented independent, angry filmmakers, Mitch represented actors in the industry, and I represented geeks and fangirls.
Yeah?
And you said dress appropriately.
Oh, God.
Yeah. So, appropriate.
Cool.
Watch the Early Late Night Live show.
Every Wednesday night at 7 on Exeter 98.
And live on YouTube.
Live long and prosper, y'all.
Arnie?
Yeah?
Get out.
Right.
I like it.
I was just told that we're not doing the credits for Trailer Trash, so we're just going to go.
Like just right now.
Just
like
right now. Into it. Yeah. So I'm actually kind of sorry Terry isn't here because I think he had a lot of opinions about this first trailer that we're going to play, which is Spencer Confidential.
Well, maybe he's watching. I'll chime in.
Yeah, that'd be good. Cool. So can we roll the trailer for Spencer Confidential? So this movie is a Netflix movie, which I know we're going to be talking about Netflix mm-hmm. later. It's about an ex-felon and former police detective Spencer who returns to Boston's criminal underworld to unravel a twisted murder conspiracy. It stars, obviously, Mark Wahlberg, Winston Duke, and Alan Arkin, and it's directed by Peter Berg. So, I've turned it over to you, Mitch. What think you of this trailer?
So, I don't know much about the history of Spencer, which is, I think, it was just recently become aware of. But watching the trailer, I started thinking that this was going to be kind of a feel-good film, and it was relationship-based and things like that. It was going to be just kind of fun and interesting and kind of whatever, vanilla. And then it kicks into this whole thing, and I loved the transition of that, and I got really interested in what was going on, and then those relationships and that early part of it became even more interesting to me. And I love Mark Wahlberg. He's just an amazing, on-screen presence and fun and cool in that regards. I don't really have a lot more to say other than that it looks really interesting and cool to me, and I'm going to probably try to go see this, if not at least catch it on streaming.
Yeah, for sure. Well, how about you, Patrick?
I really like this trailer. I think it's amazing to see how much visibility Boston is getting in the film, industry. Lately, in the last 10 years, it seems like, kind of imposed, that city as one of the major, film center, in the world, mm-hmm. And this movie itself, it has so much to do with, it is an action film, as we see here, they come and they shot the Equalizer and so on.
I was
very fond of. But I like this movie, especially whoever cut the trailer, I think they did a wonderful job. They give you an idea about the story, but you can't really figure out, the entire thing, what's really going on. Mm. And I think this is amazing. And it's good to see Mark Wahlberg, too, working here in Boston. I think it's amazing, whenever I see him. But I think this trailer, it's like the same Hollywood, your cliche in terms of, action films. Mm-hmm. I don't see anything really super special, from that end. But I think, it's definitely bring a lot of visibility to people who are working in Boston. Mm-hmm. And I think that's something, people should support, in so many ways,
Okay. I love the fact that Boston is on full display here. Like, you can tell from the way they shot it, there's no other place on the planet that this was shot but Boston. But unlike a lot of Boston films, they make it look pretty. Like, you kind of like a place you actually want to live rather than a place you just end up living, which is kind of what a lot of Boston movies do, at least for me. I love the feel of this trailer because it looks just like a lot of fun. It's just, jokes and punches and, obviously corruption. But it's got Alan Arkin in it, which is a huge
self-reality. Yeah, I forgot to mention that. I had to. Yeah. You haven't seen the Kaminsky Method yet?
He's really good in that. It's nice to see him in something lighter, because I love him in comedies especially, but he's a great actor.
Man, he cracks me up. Yeah.
Oh, my gosh. I loved him in Get Smart. He played the chief in Get Smart, and he just absolutely killed it. But anyway, so I love this film, and I like that it's a much lighter take than the original TV series, because I watched the TV series as a kid, and it was a good series, but it was very, I found it just a little too harsh, like a little too noir, if you will. But, so I really like it.
Well, I think this has a lot of potential. I mean, definitely. Mm. I mean, this movie here, I think, will do good.
I think so, too. Yeah. And the fact that it's on Netflix is great because it means I can just pop the phone and hang out.
I'm just surprised that I didn't hear about it. Like, I usually hear about the films that are being shot in Boston through the people that I work with and such. I didn't know about this. This was, like, very under the radar.
Operate that way, then, you know. Yeah. Until the movie is done, and you say, "Oh, they've made a movie with Jennifer Aniston, yeah. Like one with, you know, Eddie Murphy." You know, it goes on and on and on. Yeah.
All right. So, what's your rating of this trailer?
So the trailer overall, I'm giving it a solid 2 thumbs up because I just thought it was really well done, and I think I'm just a solid 2 thumbs up to go see the film. And so, yeah.
And you
well, I would give it the same, but with the rating, do you have like a number of stars? Just thumbs down.
But you can do like a variety of thumbs. So you don't have to do just 2 straight up, 2 straight down.
Oh, okay.
You can do whatever you want.
Thumbs up as well.
Okay. So I'm going to give it 1 solid thumb up, and I'm going to give it a wiggly thumb. Because I agree with you. It doesn't look like it's breaking any new ground. It looks like a pretty paint by the numbers film. I like it for that reason, but at the same time, I should feel more excited. Even though.
I don't want to change mine because of that.
Yeah, once the thumb is given.
No take backsies.
All right, so the next movie we're going to do is a bit of a different feel. It's called The Last Full Measure. And it's actually already out, but when I saw this trailer, I was like, this looks really good. I think this is the right film. This is the right film. Okay, great. And I was surprised that we hadn't watched it. So, it's already running. Great. So, this is already in theaters. It stars Samuel L. Jackson and Sebastian Stan, who, as you both know, were in The Avengers. It's directed by Todd Robinson. And the write-up is, 34 years after his death, Airman William H. Pitzenberger is awarded the nation's highest military honor for his actions on the battlefield in Vietnam. Obviously, there's a lot more drama than just that, but this is a great cast and a good look. So, Mitch, you want to start with?
Yeah, I admittedly watched the trailer a few days ago, and for whatever reason, I didn't get a real good, clear sense of how I felt about it, other than I do remember watching it and thinking to myself, cool, this looks really cool. And I don't really truly understand why, or remember why, but I think that in general, the idea of exposing, for lack of better words, but digging into the meaning of our history and some of the background of our soldiers and our military, and getting a little bit more in depth on that more personal side of things is, I think, something that would definitely be interesting to watch and kind of cool. The trailer looks great. I mean, and I remember being and had no problems with it, but I wish I'd watched it again, clearly. So, I've been to the wall. It's eerie and impressive all at the same time. But in general, the trailer was it was moving, but I don't really remember why.
All right, well, that's good. It left you with a good feeling. So, all right, Patrick, what was your take on this?
Well, my take on this is whenever a movie have it, like a timepiece, you know, period of it, it's always a challenge, you know, to make it look real. And I think the work they did in this movie, when you look at, you know, the Vietnam scenes that they put in this trailer, it's kind of make me want to see the film. But I wanted to see more of the timepiece in it than what's going on, you know, in modern time, you know, these days. I mean, that alone makes me want to watch the film, but at the same time, I feel like it's one of the same, you know, type of stories where, you know, it has to do with, you know, somebody that fight there, some kind of heroic ending or whatever. So I don't really have anything special in terms of, you know, what makes it different being original. But, you know, that's my take on it. I think, you know, with the timepiece scenes, I think that's one thing that I would like to check out and see what it is about, really.
That's probably one of my favorite things, too, actually, now that I think about it, is the time travel aspect of it and seeing back in time.
Yeah,
for sure.
I mean, those Vietnam War scenes that, you know, they had to stage, you know, seems pretty real to me, you know, very convincing.
So I just did... because I was double-checking my history here, and it is about the 34-year quest to have this particular soldier awarded a Medal of Honor, because he aided and defended a unit of soldiers pinned down by an enemy assault and helped save 60 men in the battle. So I like this film because it seems to show the other side of the Vietnam War. Like, we always get the story about Vietnam was bad, we were awful in it, and this seemed to show...
Or it was brutal and nasty.
Right, yeah. And we shouldn't have been there, and it's like the same old depressing story, which I'm not saying is not true, but this looks like it was trying to show you a different side of this, that even if we shouldn't have been there, and, you know, even if a lot of it was awful, there were still great heroics that came out of it. And that's what I saw when I watched this trailer. I'm like, that's a very good point, because I grew up with a lot of guys my father's age who had been in the Vietnam War, and I knew them as good men. So to me, it was something that was always present, that people, you know, would talk badly about the men who served there, but that was not the full story.
Sorry, yeah.
So I looked at this trailer, and I thought, oh, good, they're getting, you know, they're going to show another side of Vietnam, and that's great.
Interesting.
Yeah. So I don't know if that's actually what they're going to do, but in the trailer, mm-hmm. that's the sense that I got. And I love historical pieces, too, because I think that's a great way of reminding ourselves that people back then were people, too.
Actually, it's kind of reminding me of the movie we played at the Boston International Film Festival, Missing in America, with Danny Glover. Mm-hmm. It was the same thing, you know, a war hero. That went to Vietnam and fought the war, and then, you know, didn't really get acknowledged, you know, the credit that he deserved at that time. It was a great film, Missing in America. Now, I think that was back in 2005. That's a long time
ago. I've seen some amazing films at your festival, so I'm not surprised. Yeah.
We actually have to wrap up because I'm over time again.
We're good.
So why don't we give our thumbs up, and then we will move right into the last segment of our show. So, Mitch, what's your rating on
this? You know what? I'm a 2 solid thumbs up because I think the trailer looked beautiful. It does seem to cover something that isn't very often done. I love the actual time travel piece of it, looking back in history, and it looks like a really good feel-good kind of opportunity, yeah.
Okay. And
well, for me, I would give one thumbs up and then one little bit on the other side.
All right. And I'm going to give one thumb up, and I'm going to do a wiggling thumb again because I really like it, but I felt like the trailer itself could have had a bit more pep, just a touch, just to make you a little bit more excited, but that was just my take on it. All right, so we're going to go to a break, and then we're in for our final wrap-up, so definitely stick around for that. And I think we're going to play a video now, I think.
Hey, Terry, how's it going?
Hey, this laptop's having sound issues again.
Yeah, it seems to be a common theme around here.
Why would this stupid thing work?
Well, I know, IT. Let me take a look.
I feel like this happens every week. We really need to get on top of this.
I'm sure Dan's doing the best that he can.
Yeah, Dan.
Oh, there it is. You had it muted.
I did not have it muted.
And...
Damn it, Dan. You're live.
We are. Yeah.
Like
hey, welcome to live television, everybody. We're back, and before we go any further, I would like to make sure that we make mention of what is our relationship with the, how would you describe it?
So we are a proud supporter.
A proud supporter, and absolutely, Annie's Angels. Look at that, it says it right there. Annie's Angels is dedicated to helping local families struggling financially through life-threatening disease, illness, or disability, connecting neighbor to neighbor, friend to friend, and business to business, in a caring fundraising network. You can support Annie's Angels by reaching out to them at anniesangels.com.
It's actually .org.
.org. I can correct it. So it's anniesangels.org. Again, that's anniesangels.org. And so we thank you for your support. So next, we've got some news that we get to talk about. Normally, we talk about the box office, which is something that I will not do because there's really nothing to talk about.
All right.
The box office is actually pretty boring right now. I mean, in terms of just people going to see movies, the same movies as last week. A lot. The movies of last week, they made money. What are you going to do?
But you were talking about something before the show that's like, find really interesting.
Yeah.
The second, I think it's the second thing I'm
going to do. It is the second thing on the list.
I'm like, let's talk about that.
uh, So you brought this up earlier in the week, and that is the fact that the Writers Guild Association has been gearing up to renegotiate with their agents and things of that nature. And they've actually already made some strides. I mean, you guys may have heard that 7,000 writers from the guild, which is approximately 80% of their membership, was about 11,000 writers, have fired their agents because of things that they don't like going on, which is the packaging of actors and scripts or writers and so forth with production companies, as well as a production company or building a relationship and providing fees for that. And then also there's associate, like, producer type of relationships going on with some of the agents and some of these production companies that is also being raising a lot of eyebrows and saying there's a conflict of interest there, and this needs to be addressed in one way, shape, form, or another. They struck back and actually had a strike in 2008, and that was based on the digital download. You know,
yeah, I remember that. That was a big, big deal.
And the supporting of streaming for all intents and purposes. Supposedly the strike was reportedly to cost about $1.2 to $2.1 billion, and the industry cost about that much for them to strike for about 100 days.
Yeah.
About 100 days they were on strike, and we saw some of the fallout, right?
Yeah, because I remember that because I was paying close attention because I like writing. And this is, I think, just strictly mostly screenwriters and television writers.
For now,
yep. because of that strike, we had a shorter season of The Office, which I remember because I had a lot of friends that were very upset about that. But we also actually kept the show Lost longer because it was one of the few shows that actually had, I think, more episodes in the can. So it actually gained a greater following because it had fresh content while everybody else was stalled because of the writer's strike. Mm-hmm. Now, when I was doing some research on... because they're gearing up to do a strike. They're hoping that they won't
have it. Yeah, that's 2 months away from their contract ends. It's every 3 years they have a new contract or they renegotiate, and that's so it's a couple months away before that happens.
Because the funny thing is, like, the article I was reading was saying that there's actually more work for writers now than there was back in 2007 because there's something like 560 scripted shows being produced in America every year now, which is twice what they were doing then. Hmm. But the residuals are... Because they're writing for Netflix, they don't get things like, oh my God, that word just left me again.
Syndication.
Yeah, syndication. And so a lot of the deals that they made back in the day aren't working now because it's not how people are watching TV.
Yeah.
So they're just not getting compensated.
Ad-based online streaming, YouTube, ad-based advertising. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I would say all power to the writers because, I mean, there's no show, there's no movie, there's nothing without the writers.
Yep.
And I think for them to stand up for their rights, it's definitely important because there are some laws that are getting so old. And then with the evolution of technology, like, you know, that I mentioned before, they have to adjust it to support them.
Oh, sure, yeah.
Because if they are much, much more incoming revenues coming from their work, they have to be, you know, participating in in the income that is coming in. So I think for writers, man, as a writer myself, it's not easy, you know, to write. You know, it can be a very difficult.
I personally have always had a lot of respect for writers, putting their lives and their blood and their sweat and their tears and whatever they've got, you know, behind their writing and their work has always been very impressive to me. Mm-hmm. Something that I've always thought I would have a really difficult time doing. So, yeah, if I were to do that, then I would want to get paid for sure, fairly compensated.
Well, I hope they reach an agreement with them very soon and make sure that, I mean, otherwise it will go on strike.
For sure.
And we'll see what that brings.
Yeah, I don't expect it'll draw out too long, but...
you were saying Netflix might actually benefit from one of these things,
yeah,
right?
So that's an interesting little piece, right? So so there's an associate, it's called the Alliance of Motion Picture and Television Producers, I think, that was established for all of the production companies to be represented, kind of like if you're a sports fan, a players' union represents all of the players. These guys represent all of the production companies when negotiating with the union or the league or the powers that be. And they do it collectively and get consensus and so forth. Netflix is not part of that organization or that alliance, like Disney and Warner Brothers and NBC and ABC and all those other companies. So they are in a position to essentially, if they strike, then Netflix could be like, you know what, that's cool. I'm just going to go negotiate with these other guys on my own and not worry about what everybody else is doing. But that Netflix is obviously have a little bit of a sketchy history with like the Oscars, mm-hmm. who we were talking about, mm-hmm. you know, earlier, and trying to develop themselves as a legitimate mm-hmm. player in the industry. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And if they want to play, you know, with the big boys and play, they have to play by the rules. And sometimes the rules have already been dictated, and that might be, I think, I don't know.
Well, I mean, Netflix is so new in the film, you know. Distribution networks. Mm-hmm. So I think there are so many laws that was set up, you know, for television and theatrical distribution. So they didn't have anything really, you know, that really go into the streaming. And then I think they were too late in, you know, kind of make changes and adjust those rules and mm-hmm. regulations mm-hmm. to bring somebody like Netflix, you know, in terms of, you know, actors' rights, writers' rights, and producers' rights, you know, filmmakers, I mean, DPs' rights, you know, you name it, you know. So this is very, you know, interesting. I think, you know, Netflix have a lot of, you know, a free way to move around to do things.
They do, mm-hmm. yeah.
You know, but
which can be really good because I'm sure there's a lot of old rules that need to be shaken up, a lot of old systems that really could use a kick in the pants, and yeah. if Netflix is the one that brings it about, that might actually be a good thing.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, even in terms of diversity and so on, mm-hmm. you know, there are some rules that wouldn't favor, you know, like, you know, people with special ethnicity or gender or whatever. And then, you know, definitely, I think there are room to improve. Mm-hmm. And also, Netflix kind of give those space, you know, for people to really take advantage of whatever they can offer.
Right. You
know?
So
if you're a writer right now, the business could be good because companies are hiring.
If you are hiring.
Yeah. Yeah. You're a hireable union.
Need content.
Whatever. So you got stuff submitted because, you know, for a show or whatever, then it may happen. You never know. But it'll be interesting to see how that all plays out.
For sure. But I think we're running low on time.
We're getting pretty close. We've got a couple of minutes. And so Patrick, I'm going to obviously thank you for coming by. And if you had something.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, of course, man. Mm-hmm. Of course. You know, it takes you a little while to get up here. But yeah, I wanted to ask you a question real quick, give you 30 seconds. Mm-hmm. What do you tell filmmakers who want to submit to your film festival if they say, what's the biggest do or don't?
Well, I think the biggest don't is like, don't try to do your own world premiere. Try to make sure you get your film into a major film festival. It doesn't have to be Boston International Film Festival.
Okay,
I made my movies.
Yeah.
I mean, I made my movies, my first feature film in the US. I made sure I let the actors wait so we can do the world premiere in New York at the New York International Film Festival. A lot of people are making their own world premiere. I don't get it. I don't understand it.
Yeah.
They should use a network that can give them as much visibility as possible.
That's great advice. So you Boston know. International Film Festival, don't do it yourself.
even though
you probably could. But,
it's easy to do, yeah. But you know, if you want to take full advantage, yeah.
Absolutely. Well, we thank you all for joining us tonight, and we hope Terry's car is running well and his mechanic's shirt is still intact. And I mean, so next week is our guest offhand, do you know?
Oh, yes. So next week we will be having Mark Haggad.
Mark Haggad.
Yes. So he's a writer, director, and star of the new short film Batman, One Final Joke. And we'll also have Christopher Jacques, who plays Nightwing in the film.
Very cool.
That's going to be really fun.
Awesome. Thanks again, everybody, for joining. And tune in next week for Mark Haggad, a little Batman talk. It should be fun. And we'll see you next week. And on behalf of Terry.
Hey, you made it. Thank you for watching our show. And be sure to join us next week at 7 p.m. on our YouTube channel, The Early Late Night Live Show in Exeter, Channel 98.
And if you have any questions or want to be a guest on the show, you can email killarneyt@gmail.com. There might be a link or some info somewhere around here.
Somewhere around here.
Below. Mm-hmm. And if you haven't already, like and subscribe on Facebook and YouTube. You won't regret it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They won't regret it.
Yeah.